The Dharma, incomparably profound and exquisite, is rarely met with even in hundreds of thousands of millions of kalpas. We now can see it, hear it, accept it, hold it. Maybe realize the true mind of the Tathagata. Today is the final day, the seventh day, and the final day of this seven-day session here at Mountain Gate in July 2018. And it's been a very, very fine, increasingly deep session. Important thing is not to stop there, but to keep taking it deeper, because our capacity is far greater than it was even a few hours ago, simply because of the exercise of focusing our mind and continuing the yearning, the question, and the extended out breath, reaching for that deep truth at face before our parents were born, that profundity of what we are. So we will continue sharing Frank Ostasevsky's book, The Five Invitations, Discovering What Death Can Teach Us About Living Fully. It's an excellent book. It's yes, it's about people dying, but it's also relevant to our daily life, because in every moment we're dying to something. We're dying to a past moment. We're dying to a feeling that's going away. We're dying to a person, perhaps, that's going away, or a pet that's dying. Or we're dying to a desire to have something be a certain way when it's clear that it can't be that way anymore. There's so many little deaths in our days. We don't think about it. We think about this great big death at the end of the so-called life, and that's usually so scary for people. It's been called the elephant in the living room, which is a classic statement around alcoholism. There's this enormous thing right there in the middle of your life, in the middle of your living room, and everybody avoids recognizing it, right, avoids talking about it. And death is one of those elephants. Unless we happen to be someone like Frank Ostasevsky, who has made a lifetime of working with people in hospice, and through that has learned a tremendous amount about living, and living fully, and living a rich life. Just today, I think it was, a woman was found who had been driving down the coast road in California, swerved to avoid a small animal that started dashing out into the road and went off a 250-foot high cliff into the ocean. She was injured, but not mortally. Had broken bones, a brain bleed, and some other things, and ended up extremely sunburned because she was there for, I think it was 6 days, quite a long time before she was rescued, because it was way off the, out of sight for people, you know, 250 feet down into the ocean. If you're driving along, you're paying much more attention to where those guardrails are than what the view might be beyond. And anyway, because it was straight down, she was quite out of sight. And she had a tremendous amount of grit and survived through that. She also was very creative. She apparently had a tool in her car that enabled her to break through a window, because when the crash happened, the power went out on the car, and of course the window's locked. There was no way to put them down or up, and so she had to break her way out of the car. But she happened to have in the car a tool with which to do that. So she got out of the car and got to shore. She wasn't very far into the surf, but she was far enough in the surf that even at the shore, she would climb to the highest place she could find every evening and fall asleep. She was actually spontaneously falling asleep a lot of times, probably because of that brain injury. And she would always wake up soaked wet. The tide had come in and it hadn't drowned her, but it had definitely gotten her wet. And it wasn't until so many days later that some people who'd been surfing decided to take a walk on the beach and came upon her. Actually, she sort of woke up and saw a woman, but she thought she was hallucinating. Nonetheless, she got up as quickly as she could and ran over to the woman, and the woman was for real. And the rescuers were able to get to her, and she survived. And her comment in the hospital, where she was being treated for the broken bones and the brain bleed and severe sunburns, was, "Life is incredible. Life is incredible. It's so amazing." Her sister came to visit, and they were laughing so hard, she said that the broken bones hurt. And this is another thing that Frank has pointed out, that as we get close to death, we realize there's not a lot of time left. And maybe there's no time left. And suddenly, we let go self-images, if we're fortunate, and are able to be so present with the moment that it is just as it always is, that we don't normally notice because we're so filled with an overlay of ideas, assumptions, thoughts, concepts, and so on. It's always incredible. It's always amazing. And we can return there through the practice. Every time we extend the out-breath, where we are practicing, refocusing, letting go of what would distract us otherwise. And it adds up. The more we can do it, the deeper we can go into that spaciousness that exists when we allow ourselves to dive beneath the camouflage. I think that's a good word for it. Who we are is very different from who we think we are. So, the five invitations. I'd like to share something quite cogent that Frank says in this. The great spiritual and religious traditions have any number of names for the unnameable, the absolute, God, Buddha nature, true self. All these names are too small. In fact, all names are too small. Their fingers pointing at the moon. I invite you to translate the terms I use in whatever way helps you connect with what you know and trust most in your heart of hearts. I will use the simple term being to point at that which is deeper and more expansive than our personalities. At the heart of all spiritual teachings is the understanding that this being is our most fundamental and benevolent nature. Our normal sense of self, our usual way of experiencing life, is learned. It's learned, we're taught. It's very, very clear and very obvious. Children learn by mimicking people around them. They learn speech. They learn how to be in certain circumstances. And they also develop along the way a sense of who they are. And for some reason in our Western culture, it's often a sense of lack. We're not good enough. And some modern religions play on that and say that we're sinned, and we are sinners at the very beginning. We're born with sin. And that's quite a death sentence right there. How are you going to get beyond that? And Buddhism, we think the opposite. Everyone, everything is perfect just as it is. And we can open to that innate perfection, which is far beyond words. And to call it being, we are the beingness of the universe. One Catholic priest who had a deep awakening after many, 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 many years of meditation and eventually leaving the church, he called it, he said, we are the outpressing of God. And that's quite an apt way of putting it if you have to put it into words. We are the outpressing of God. While we may appear to be distinct beings, we are one beingness. And we can awaken to that. And the deeper we open to that, the more free we will be to live the rest of our life in a very different and joyous way. Our normal sense of self, our usual way of experiencing life, is learned. The conditioning that occurs as we grow and develop can obscure our innate goodness. Being has certain attributes or essential qualities that live as potentials within each of us. These qualities help us to mature, to become more functional and productive. They fill out our humanity and add a richness, beauty, and capacity to our lives. These pure qualities include love, compassion, strength, peace, clarity, contentment, humility, and equanimity, to name a few. Through practices such as contemplation and meditation, we can quiet our minds, hearts, and bodies, and as a result, our ability to sense our experience becomes subtler and more penetrating. In a discovered stillness, we are able to perceive the presence of these innate qualities. They're more than emotional states, though we may feel them at first as emotions. It might be more helpful to think of them as inner guidance system, which can lead us to a greater sense of well-being. These aspects of our essential nature are inseparable from being, as wetness is from water. Said another way, we already have everything we need for this journey. It all exists within us. We don't need to be someone special to access our innate qualities and utilize them in the service of greater freedom and transformation. All we have to do is uncover them. And that's quite a work. Depends on how deeply we are invested in this sort of camouflage. The more we can see through it, and that happens as we do the practice. As I said, the freer we become, the more we are, I wouldn't even say become aware of these innate qualities, the more we embody them. Because being aware of something can assume somebody standing outside the qualities and looking at them. But it's about being them, which we are. And in order to be able to live them fully, and certainly all of us are able to access a certain level of these qualities. We all care. We all have compassion, certain levels of humility, and so on and so forth. But we can go deeper. We can let go more and be so free that these qualities naturally infuse our behavior moment by moment. A natural inner guidance system, as he says. So then he goes into his invitations. first one is don't wait. Don't look for some future time when you're going to do the practice. Right now is when you have the chance. Right now is maybe the only time you'll have the chance. Take advantage of it. The second one is welcome everything and push away nothing. And that's very important because most of us have had instances in our life where things have been difficult, challenging. Just going to high school is challenging for most people. All the peer pressure and the various other activities that go along, who's popular, who's not, which is a shifting change of scene. One person is popular one day and on the outs the next. It's a real adventure for most people. The third is bring your whole self to the experience. Don't hold back. Don't think that you can remain here in this safe cave and somehow open to the incredibleness of life, because you can't. You have to be brave and walk out right into it. Allow yourself to experience it fully, not to reject any feeling, any sensation that comes up, but to be curious about it, to explore it. It could be the key to liberation. Often it is, because as we do our practice, things will come up, we'll bring things up, this is the nature of Makyo, that appear to block us. And in a certain way, that's what they're there for. As I've said so many times, naturally there is a sense that we have, a drive, a yearning to truly become free and to understand, to comprehend the true nature of reality. But then as we get, so to speak, out of sight of shore, we get a little scared. Are we going to be able to find our way back? Are we going to disappear off the edge of the earth? It wasn't until sailors began to learn how to navigate by the stars that they dared to sail outside of land. And that's when some of the great world explorations began to unfold. Before that, they hugged the shore. It was thought then, of course, that the world was flat anyway, and you got too far away and you'd fall off the edge. And who knows what would meet you at that point. We have to be brave. It takes courage to do practice, because we will be facing things that we've hidden from ourselves. To feel safe, to feel okay, to feel secure. And yet these things are driving us in the background. And if we truly want to be free, we have to turn around and take a look and explore. What are the subtleties of these things? Do they really feel as awful as it seems like they do? And often when we do turn and face them, they're not anywhere near as awful feeling as we think they are when they're behind our backs. Fourth, find a place of rest in the middle of things. Find a place of rest in the middle of things. Sosokan, the extended out-breath, is perfect for that. It activates the parasympathetic nervous system, which is the rest and relax aspect of our nervous system, as opposed to the fight or flight aspect. It's very grounding. It can actually limit or prevent, or interrupt, I should say, not so much. Well, it can prevent too. It can interrupt a panic attack. There's a psychotherapist that just recently came up with a sort of a variant of Susokan for working with panic attacks, and he calls it 7-11. You breathe in for a count of seven, but then you breathe out for a count of 11. So you're extending the out-breath. The act of counting the seven and counting the 11 helps distract our mind from the energy that is initiating the panic. And of course, as we extend the out-breath, we're balancing it out and we're activating that parasympathetic nervous system to dampen it down. So we can find rest in the middle of chaos. And the fifth is cultivate don't know mind. If we think we know, there's no room for learning. There's no room for anything to unfold, to be revealed. It's like we've shut the book. But if we allow ourselves to be curious, not to know necessarily, then it's amazing what we can discover. And in that discovery, there can be many things that can be liberating. This is why we engage a kind of curiosity in our practice, a perplexity, this so-called great doubt, because it's essential. If we're just sitting there, just breathing out, and breathing in, and breathing out, and breathing in, and breathing out, it can be grounding, it can be restful, it can be a nice thing to do. But unless we add that element of perplexity, as we breathe out, what might be revealed? And in our daily life, are we living it fully? Are we comprehending everything that can be comprehended? Isn't there something more? And there is. And we can open to it and realize it and live it because it's built in. Then I leave you with this quote by Sogyal Rinpoche. Whatever we've done with our lives makes us what we are when we die. And everything, absolutely everything, matters. Whatever we've done with our lives makes us what we are when we die. And everything, absolutely everything counts. Everything, absolutely everything counts. We've all heard, most likely, that when people are on the brink of death, their life flashes through past their eyes, and they see clearly for a change exactly how they've behaved. And this may be part of what happens to some people when they get close to death and they are transformed. They suddenly, their personalities change in very positive ways. They let go old negative feelings. They apologize to people that they've hurt. They change radically in positive ways, because somehow they've seen more clearly. I remember my grandmother, who lived to be 93, and one day my uncle, her son, and his wife were called to where she was living because she'd been crying for an entire day. And they couldn't get out of her why she was crying. So they finally called Dave and Maggie and said, can you figure out what's going on with her? She cried literally for a day and a half. She was a pretty strong-willed lady. And I gather she was a formidable mother when my mother was growing up. by the time I lived with her, she was pretty benign, kind of neat. We got along really well, although I must say we had some arguments. I remember once when she was driving me up to Cleveland, where my parents were living at the time, and in those days before the freeways, it took an hour and a half to get up from Youngstown to Cleveland. And she had made some negative comment about Catholics. And I was arguing the opposite, that all Catholics are not bad. And we argued the entire way to Cleveland Heights. And finally she said, "I don't want to talk about it anymore," which meant I won. But it was a harmonious argument, if you can call arguments harmonious. I mean, there was no acrimony in it. I was playing devil's advocate, plus I didn't believe what she was saying anyway. So it turns out, in that day and a half, what I suspect is that she had seen her life clearly and saw in high relief where she might not have behaved in the way she would rather have behaved. And it wrenched her heart. Not long after that, she died. And I would say that she, in realizing what she had realized, and in asking forgiveness, whatever you want to call it, as far as I know, she wasn't religious at that point, just the awareness of her behavior and the regret in it was enough to transform her so that she could die peacefully. But we don't have to die to do that. And if you also take as a fundamental truth that we are not flawed to begin with, we are wondrous human beings. We're the beingness of the universe, with all the innate compassion and wisdom, capacity for joy, for caring, for loving, for forgiving, for humility. We can open to it and make it possible to live fully from that place of let-go-ness. And when we are able to do that, if something comes up, it may be a minor blip, or it may not be a blip at all. We will be able to see it clearly enough that it won't grab us. It's a very different way of living than most people live. I leave you with that. And I pray that each one of you will take this to heart and dive deep into your practice in a very committed, ongoing way, so that you can uncover this true beingness that you are. Thank you for listening. We'll stop now and recite the four vows.